This evening on The Rock Newman Show, we're dedicating the entire hour to DC's most indigenous musical sound. That would be go-go. Sherita Cookie Whiting and KK, the daughters of go-go godfather Chuck Brown, discussed the legacy of his music and his life. Jimmy Dugan's go-go pioneer and founding member of the Young Senators is also here to talk about the origins of the musical genre, and band leader Big G share how he's helping to keep go-go music alive in the new age. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Go-go music got its start in Washington, D.C. in the mid-1960s and was introduced to the world by the Young Senators, infusing funk and heavy percussion. Go-go gained steam in the 1970s, and D.C. native Chuck Brown pushed the unique sound forward, pioneering a musical explosion right here in Washington, D.C. and beyond. His musical influence would earn him the title, the Godfather of Go-Go. Good evening. Chuck Brown's daughter, Sherita Cookie Whiting, joins me now to discuss his musical journey and impact. I'm also joined by Young Senators founding member Jimmy Dugans and Big G, leader of D.C.'s popular backyard band. All three of you, welcome to the show. I give you a standing ovation for showing up.
Thank you.
Wherever I might have traveled, anywhere in the world, when I was gone for long times from D.C., I'd come back and I'd on the plane, train, or car coming in, there'd be two things that was on my mind. One would be making sure that my favorite place had big crabs. And the second thing was to listen to some go-go, because maybe somewhere where I was in the other parts of the world, I wasn't hearing it. Now, I say that, but more and more, as I traveled, I would hear go-go other places. And one distinct time I remember being in Bermuda, and I was standing, actually waiting for a bus in Bermuda, and someone drove by, and I heard this familiar voice. I was driving in my car one day, a sexy lady looked my way. That happened to have been your daddy. Chuck Brown, hi, Cookie.
Hi, honey.
Thanks
How
for joining.
You? Thank you.
Jimmy, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Big G, again, thank you guys.
Thank you.
Okay, you know what I'm gonna do, Jimmy? I'm gonna go to you first. Mm-hmm. Chuck Brown's stature was so big, his persona so exemplified the genre of music, he got named the Godfather of Go-Go. In doing some research, we come upon that the original sound, initially, you guys, as founding member of the Young Senators, you all played it early. Tell us what it was, what you were doing, and how you first came upon hitting those go-go beats.
How it came about, Philip Gilbo, he was a trumpet player. Mm-hmm. He had an idea. He was on the bus coming back from Detroit. He came to me and asked me, say, I got this song called Jungle. I didn't want to hear that, you know.
Right.
Way down, you know, he's way down yonder. He couldn't sing, but he played the trumpet. He played with Ray Charles. Anyway, he was discussing this, and I didn't want to hear it, man. You know, I was like, hey, go talk to Warnell, that's a bass player.
Yeah.
Go talk to him. So he talked to everybody on the bus. So he came back, we came back to D.C. We started rehearsing,
yeah.
You know, rehearsing a song called Jungle. Uh-huh. And that's how it came about, Jungle. Dun, 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 dun. Listen to it,
and where so that familiar bongo drum beat that you hear, that was included at the time also.
Yes, ba doom boom bop, ba doom boom bop, ba doom bop. That's me playing Kungas. Uh-huh. This was, no disrespect, this came way before Chuck Brown. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. This was early on. Mm-hmm. Early mm-hmm. on. Mm-hmm. And then later, I'm trying to bring it up to par. Then when we disbanded,
right,
Leroy went with Chuck Brown.
Uh-huh.
Chuck Brown, the Soul Surgeons, right?
Sure.
So he, his spirit, young Cinder's spirit was with him.
Mm-hmm.
If you listen to Bustin' Loose, listen to Jungle by the Young Senators, mm-hmm. similarity is there.
Mm-hmm.
It's there.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way you can get around it.
I'm sure Cookie and both G would say, mm-hmm. Chuck had such a big spirit mm-hmm. and had such an all-inclusive and open spirit that whatever the reality was that, you know, Chuck would not have any issue with acknowledging.
Oh, absolutely not. He, you know, was able to stand on his own, and he brought this genre out to everyone mm-hmm. and introduced it to everyone so that they could understand the point of the music was to come out and have fun.
Yeah.
The point of the music was to come out and dance your butt off.
Yeah.
The point of the music was to bring everybody together,
mm-hmm.
and that's what Chuck Brown was
about.
And
I want to talk about that bringing everybody together. I want to actually go at some, I'm going to come back to Chuck Brown's funeral, which was one of the biggest funerals in the history of Washington, D.C., and some things that people said then, some feelings I had. I want to come back to that. But Big G is with us just for part of the show. When he leaves, he's going to be replaced by KK, who had that response to, I was driving in the car one day. Yeah.
She actually wrote some of that, too.
All right. So as a youngster, do you remember not being aware of go-go, or does it feel to you like it was something that's like in your DNA?
Yeah, it's in my DNA. I had to have it. Just learning from Pop, from Chuck, because that's what we call him.
Sure.
Pop. Just like structuring go-go, the whole thing with the call and response.
Yeah.
He was that person that he wanted to see like you. He was familiar with your face when you come and see him play. So
calling out names.
Names.
Yeah.
Actually, nobody wouldn't really let Backyard play. So Chuck gave me my first, I was 15 years old, Kilimanjaro. I wasn't even supposed to be in Kilimanjaro.
Right.
And Chuck gave me my chance. And that was it from there. But different people like, gee, Chuck don't let nobody come in when he getting himself together. He don't let nobody come back there. So he always let me come back there. So I wanted to come back there every time we played in the Kilimanjaro. He always let me in there.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? If he ain't in the
come
limo,
back there, meaning be back
come
there with
his
Chuck
little
is.
Dressing room.
Right,
yeah.
Right, right, right.
So I learned a lot.
Right.
You know what I mean? And just following his style
mm-hmm.
and just creating my own. But the way he paved that way
right.
was amazing.
Uh-huh.
You know what? While I'm with you here, G, because you do have to leave in a little bit, and I don't want to get going and forget this. Big G, who you've seen on The Wire and many other TV shows, in addition to being all over the DMV and other places, you know, rocking out the go-go beat, just recently got a shoe named after him. And if you don't mind taking your foot from under the table and kind of
yeah.
sticking it up, the cameraman get a look at that shoe.
DC
That's the
51.
Big G. That's the Big G shoe.
Yeah, it'll be out November 11th under the Patrick Ewing line.
Yeah.
And the DC 51 statehood. So the mayor's going to give me the ambassador of DC on that day.
Uh-huh.
And just the movement of our music, not like when I used to meet with Chuck Pop, he told me, don't let our music die, son.
Yeah.
Go beyond the limits of where you can go. I'd have been all overseas. Now it's time for you guys to go. So we got so much more to do.
Uh-huh.
So much more to do. I just think if we stick together a little more, then we can really do it. We can go on tour, all of us together. Everybody got to put them differences to the side. Like if Pop was still living,
yeah.
it'd have been, the committee would have been like jammed together. We'd probably been in like 4 or 5 different countries by now.
Uh-huh.
But mm-hmm. you know, everybody mm-hmm. got that ego now. They mm-hmm. want to be like, mm-hmm. since Pop not here, I'm the man.
And so did you get out of your time with the Godfather of Go-Go, did you get out of that time, his understand, sort of tap into his sense
yeah.
of an all-inclusive mindset?
Yeah.
And here was a man that was doing his God-given mission, because that's the sense I would get and what I would hear so many other people say. You know, they're enjoying themselves because Lord knows Chuck is up there enjoying
yeah.
himself.
Yeah. He just kept it fresh, you know? He kept that tank top on, that hat, and that guitar. He'd go for hours just playing.
Yeah.
And then he also taught you to sit down. Look, don't be a fool. I got in trouble when I was on TV.
Yeah.
And I met him for my birthday. He gave me a couple of dollars in an envelope and said, "You want to be a leader or you want to be a fool? You got to be able to structure yourself and show the ones that's going to come behind you where you need to go, and don't let our music fall off." Because a lot of times they'll box you in one box.
Yeah.
You got to be able to keep that variety and keep that flavor and that sound.
So he's the godfather of go-go, but he was also a whole lot of folks'
a whole
godfather
lot.
Also.
Yeah, absolutely.
Big G has to leave. And what we're going to do is we're going to put KK, who's Chuck Brown's daughter and played and wrote some of his music, to fill that chair there. And what we're going to do now is we're going to take a quick break and let you enjoy the go-go sounds of Familiar Faces. Here they go performing a cover of Ruff Inn's Someone to Love.
Hey, Sabre. Whoa! Yeah!
Folks, we've had a little set change, and if you should happen to see those out there in viewer land, if you should happen to see me smiling a little bit, it's because I love go-go, man. And I've been talking about doing this show for like a couple of years. So if it looks like we might be having fun here, we are. KK has joined us, Chuck's daughter, who actually performs on, you heard me saying, I was riding in my car one day. I just want to keep on saying that. get my swag thing on.
Yeah, bring him on stage.
A sexy lady looked my way. That was KK. KK, I want to isolate that song for a moment.
Okay.
When you ask people what's their favorite Chuck Brown song, 10 people might tell you 10 different things. You know, I mean, because Chuck touched a lot of people in a lot of different ways. Mm-hmm. On that particular song, you had a hand in writing that song. Mm-hmm. So help us out, kind of going behind the scene, and help us understand how that song came about,
okay,
what you contributed to it, mm-hmm, and sort of what the process was back and forth with Chuck and whoever else might have been involved.
Okay, the dude who wrote the song is Kevin Blackman. His name is Uno. He wrote the song. He wrote it for my dad, mm-hmm, but my dad was like, no, I want my daughter on the song. So when I went in the studio with Uno, we, you know, collaborated and got the verse that I do. Because
mm-hmm,
he actually wrote the whole song for my father.
Mm-hmm.
But my father wanted me on the song, so I wasn't really a fan of nobody writing nothing.
Yeah.
But my father wanted me on the song, so I did it, and we got a Grammy nomination, so Uno did his thing.
You know, and okay, so Chuck just had some instincts about the song.
Mm-hmm.
Was it that particular, so it was that particular song, how it was presented to him?
Yeah.
His vision was,
I want my daughter on the song.
I want my daughter on the song. We want doing something.
Yep.
Uh-huh. So he came to you and said what?
He said, I got this song, I want you to get on it. And I said, what is it? He was like, it's called Chuck Baby. I said, okay, that's tight, let me hear it. So, you know, we listen to it, and I help him, you know. But my father write verses all the time, but he just wants some younger input and, you know,
yeah,
and feed, because he's been writing songs for years. But Uno wrote the song. We went in the studio, listened to it. So then we collabed. He's like, where your baby father from? I told him from Uptown. And, you know, so that's how it happened. Basically, like, we was in Chucky Thompson's studio at the time. And it was just good vibes and cool. Like, cause when I first seen Uno, I was like, who's this? Excuse me, I don't need nobody writing for me. I mean, that's exactly what I said. Uno was laughing.
So you was quoting yourself.
Yeah.
You wasn't really saying that.
Yeah,
you didn't really say that.
I really said it.
No, I'm talking about here right now.
Really, my bad. I really said that. So the hem of my father was nervous. So Uno was like, yeah, like, you know, I'm not the enemy, I'm here. But, you know, that's just how artists is, some people. But
so something so fascinating, and I isolate that song. We could do it on all of Chuck's songs. Mm-hmm. But there's something that kids in 2016 mm-hmm. might not really understand. When you said something, you get out of something faster than MacGyver did.
Yeah, get out of a jam.
Get out of a jam faster than MacGyver did.
That's in real life, though.
Talk to me.
In real life, say, like, you, I got this quote I got on my legs. I got a lot of tattoos on my body. So it's a quote that says, some people live to see things, others see things to live. So you have to know how to get out of certain situations in order to live. You have to see something to change your life for you to live. You get what I'm saying? So it just depends on what situation you go through. You just got to know how to get out of it quick. So it's really all brain. Like, people use their mouth or they use their brain, but it's really your brain first. So you use your brain, then your mouth will know what to say.
But you know, KK, if I can slip in, KK is a freestyler.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Like, when she comes on the stage with Dad, you know, when you know, Dad was still alive, she just get up there. And I could tell when she would be in the zone because she would just go so hard. I mean, like, you know, you can stand her next to any rapper and she can go on them.
Yeah.
You know, especially just don't give her nothing that's written. Let her do her thing.
Of course. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And so here's what I'd like to do here on the Rock Newman Show.
Uh-oh.
This is my show.
I know that's right.
So we can do some special things.
Okay.
What I'd like to do is if you would go through that introductory verse that we were talking about, MacGyver, will you mind me putting you on the spot and having you to bust that for a second?
No, that's good.
Go on. Tell her to do the TV rated.
yeah, the TV rated one, right.
Remember this, KK, you have to give her a clear instruction.
I used to say I would never, not in my days, ever change my ways. Too good at getting away with all them games I played. Smooth walker, slick talker, anything I did. Get out of a jam quicker than MacGyver, you dig?
Get out of a jam quicker than MacGyver,
quicker than MacGyver.
Jimmy, coming back to you on that note, talking about getting out of jam quicker than MacGyver did. You guys had the Young Senators.
Yes, sir.
And pioneered, as it said in the opening there,
yes, sir.
Pioneered the sound initially. You had a real run here in D.C. of popularity. You see your name on the billboards and all the rest. And then you guys made a significant career change. Tell us about that career change and how that impacted your life.
That career change you're talking about is with Eddie Kendricks?
Absolutely.
Yes, sir. That came about in 1972. 72.
And anybody don't already know, because we're talking about Eddie Kendricks, who was lead singer.
The Temptations.
Of the Temptations.
Yes.
Keep on, well, let me let you.
Right, well, we recorded with Eddie. We was his touring band, recording band, as well as TV taping and everything. Mm-hmm. We were his band, backup band. Mm-hmm. And that was a tremendous amount of everything.
Which songs did you? Because you guys had some big hits.
Yes.
With Eddie Kendrick, then.
Yes.
Played with him on some really big hits.
Yeah. Girl, Need to Change Your Mind was one. Keep on Trucking, and Boogie Down. Just the name
Boogie
of it.
Boogie Down, baby.
And we did the albums with him. Yeah.
Yeah. And so you guys traveled everywhere.
Everywhere where you saw him, you saw us.
How did that come about?
That came about through me.
Okay.
I met him at the Go-Go. The Monday Night Go-Go.
Okay.
The Monday Night Go-Go. And he was appearing, the Temptations was appearing in town.
Right.
And I went to see him, and then next thing you know, I didn't have the nerve enough to speak to him.
Yeah.
I was nervous, man.
Sure.
So I told him I had to leave. I didn't have to leave. I have to be there at the Burn Manor about 10 o'clock.
Right.
But I told him I had to leave. I couldn't stay because I just got
You're
nervous.
Getting ready to have a chance to meet Eddie Kendricks.
Yeah.
But you were intimidated by the moment.
Yes, sir.
And said you had to leave.
Yes, sir.
And then what?
Because so
see, this, we make history here on the Rock Newman Show.
Okay, come on with it.
People don't understand this.
Yeah. So we went to Burn Manor.
Yeah.
And I told him Eddie Kendricks was coming out there.
Yeah.
They didn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't believe it. They were like, I was a laughing stock.
Right.
So finally, Eddie showed up.
Yeah.
Him, Paul Williams, and Cornelius Grant, the guitar player, and the bodyguard.
Yeah.
And Burn Manor. You never went to Burn Manor.
Yeah, but a hot club. Yeah. Hot club.
It was a dance hall.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And PG Cop, Cops didn't play.
Yeah.
You had to dress to impress mm-hmm. when you came out there. So mm-hmm. I told the people that, you know, Eddie Kendrick's coming out there. So quite naturally, they laughed.
Yeah.
They didn't believe me. Mm-hmm. I told the band members, they all laughed at me. And lo and behold, we was on the stage. And I saw a commotion coming forward.
Yeah.
They didn't have no fights out there.
Yeah.
No fights.
Yeah.
So the commotion was coming forward to the stage. Mm-hmm. And we looked at each other, what's happening? So we didn't stop playing, we just kept going. So yeah. Finally, there was Eddie Kendricks.
Yeah.
And he betted for me to come down.
Yeah.
To come down. You know, I was yeah. on the stage quite
sure.
naturally.
Sure.
And come on down. And he invited us to the Watergate, mm-hmm. the hotel he was staying mm-hmm. at. Mm-hmm. And after the show, I said, man, it's gonna be kind of late. He said, don't worry about it, just yeah. come on over.
Right, right.
So I went over to the hotel and meet him, and the rest is history.
The rest is history. Young yes, senators hooked up with Eddie Kendricks,
Eddie
one of the biggest names in the business yes, at sir. That time.
Yes, sir.
Cookie, I know you have so very many stories to share, both of you guys. What I'd like to do is to go, when you ask people what's their favorite Chuck song, Chuck Brown song, you ask 10 people, mm-hmm. you might get 10 different answers. Universally, people are probably most familiar with Bustin' Loose. Mm-hmm. Take us back to the time of Bustin' Loose being done, being put together, and the reaction and the responses that you all saw and felt while Chuck was performing that song in the earlier days.
For me, I think it would go back to, remember when Dad did that show with James Brown at the old convention center?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I was begging to be one of the MCs because they had different MCs, and I had on, remember that picture with the gold dress? I was begging to be an MC and bring out Dad when he came on stage when he was playing with James Brown. And then I got on stage and froze. But, you know, being...
You got intimidated by, by the moment also.
Yeah,
right.
You know, uh-huh. First I wanted to do and then I got out there, I didn't know what to say.
Uh-huh.
But the old convention center, if you remember it, how it was just so huge and just so mm-hmm.
no
separation
question.
To it, was just huge. Yeah. And then coming out there and seeing all those people. And when Dad came out and was doing Bustin' Loose, just like, it looked like you're looking at millions of people just out there partying.
Yeah.
You know, that's a very fond memory for me of Bustin' Loose early on, because back then I was young, and so that means she was even younger.
Even younger, sure.
I still remember.
Right.
And I just know everybody that influenced him was like people before him, like James Brown,
mm-hmm. uh-huh.
Bobby Parker.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
So if anybody started that genre of any type of music, it definitely was my father for DC, because they all loved him. You get what I'm saying? And they know he had that spunk. He came out of Lawton, playing in Lawton. You get what I'm saying? So he started way before Streets and everybody saying it's like, so many people talk about how Go-Go got started, but the recognition got to my father. You know what I'm saying? He was the one that pushed it out there and went forward and let you know, this is where he's not from DC, since I heard somebody say that. He was born in North Carolina. He came here when he was 5. If you in the city over 10 years, you from DC.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? He been in the city his whole life. You get what I'm saying? He was 5 years old.
And he taught himself.
And he taught himself how to play. So
taught himself how to
any
play.
Influence he got was from God. You know what I'm saying? It was from him playing and him learning how to teach himself how to play. So it wasn't no, he, you know, heard this or that. He got influenced by a lot of music. Go-Go is a lot of music mixed together, not just one type of music.
Yeah, and you know, something that I think people are not as much aware of is the different kind of music that Chuck did.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
That's why I say it's
gospel,
all music mixed together.
Gospel, jazz,
it's everything
rock,
mixed together.
Rock.
Calypso.
Yeah. Yes.
Everything. You know, like he did stuff with Los Latinos. Like he did all types of music with different people, so you can't just say that he didn't start.
He did a big concert out in California with what's the guy's
Carlos
name?
Carlos Santana.
Yeah.
Chuck Brown and Carlos Santana.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's been to Japan all over the world.
She's been to Japan
so
with them everywhere
with, him, so.
With them, you know.
I don't like when people shun that and try to make my father look like he did what he did. He's a great man, and I'm not gonna let nobody shun what he did.
Yeah, no, I don't think anyone would. Again, in terms of, you know, the how Chuck and his reputation just, you know, morphed. I mean, it just, you know, it just grew.
Yeah, he had his days. He used to be on drugs. He used to knock people out. He used to do everything. He was also a good person, like a real man all around the board. He was the man.
Yeah,
I think one of the best later down the line memories is when he got his street sign. And what made it so special for me with working in D.C. government and being able to get it, a lot of people get their street signs after they're gone.
Yeah.
But he got it while he was here. And I'll never forget that Vincent Gray said he wanted to recognize that Chuck Brown was sitting in the audience during the council hearing and that he was in tears. And see, Chuck was one of the most humble people you could ever meet.
Right.
With all that he had, he was always giving and always doing for others. And that's what people don't know.
That's what they don't
You know, that's what they don't know. Always. I mean, we used to go to schools where he would read to elementary kids. Last school I went to with Dad was over at Hart. And we sat in there. And so to see little kids that, you know, probably only get to see video music but knew who Chuck Brown was when he walked into school is what you want in your legacy. You know what I'm saying? That's what you want in your legacy. And just, I don't know anybody who you can march in here or anywhere else that could say one bad thing about Chuck Brown.
Right.
You know?
Well, you know, I was talking to Jimmy before the show, and Jimmy was talking about how, because I asked him, did the young senators ever, you know, perform when Chuck was performing?
And he did shows together.
Certainly, yes. I mean, there definitely is no kind of effort in any kind of way to minimize, just in terms of when the sort of the very first sound, you know, I mean, we look at, there's a piece like in the Washington Post we saw, I think it was the Washington Post, African-American, one of them, where you guys were referred to as the Empress. As the Empress. And, you know, how Chuck came and took and
it's
just
like rap
grew
music.
It. Yeah.
It doesn't matter who you say started it.
I know he done told the stories and I believe what my father said.
Sure.
It's just like I said with rap music, you know, everybody is a rapper, but you know, somebody is carrying that torch of rap and moving it where others are coming up under them. You know what I mean? And like with Go-Go, you know, everyone in Team Familiar, which is the band that I'm a co-manager, has learned from Chuck and has been on the stage with Chuck and honors everything that they do by living by him. I mean, when we have in meetings, when they're in rehearsal, I can't tell you how many times Mickey or somebody else or Darnell is saying Pops would have did this or Pops had this going on or Pop, because that's what everybody calling Pop. Everybody has they know it's an unknown. You don't have to say the respect that's there for him, you know, but these guys who are now playing in the various bands now have that opportunity because of Chuck Brown, you know, and they honor him every night that they go out and play and do right and give back to the community and be, you know, upstanding citizens, because that's all that he would preach to people.
Yeah, so let me ask you, and Jimmy, I want to see if you have thoughts on this. We're talking about Go-Go, we're talking about music that come out of record companies and that was done by, you know, high-level professionals. Part of Go-Go that I know and remember, riding when I was at Howard University from 1970 to 1974, was going over to Georgetown, seeing some brothers sitting on the corner with some tubs and some buckets
and some sticks,
rocking it over there. So tell us about that time.
That came about, I don't know what year, but it's all about God. It's about God.
Yeah.
It's about the rhythm. Now I'm a kunga player, percussionist, so I know what I'm saying. It's coming by that. Beating on the drums, beating on the sticks or whatever. It's just rhythm.
Yeah.
Black people have rhythm.
But here's what I wanted to try to isolate, and you know, anybody can jump in. Sure, it is very clear. You know, the African roots.
Yes, sir.
You know, you see it manifest in so many different ways. I spent hours talking with Quincy Jones about that.
Come on.
But in particular, if you were to drive around town on a Saturday evening during the time I'm talking about, and for many years later also, you might hear, you know, Chuck on the radio or EU at the time or whoever it might have been, you'd hear them on the radio, but these guys that I'm talking about that were in Georgetown, they were also in Southeast. You know, mm-hmm. they were in Northeast. They were down off of South Capitol Street.
They're down at the Gallery Place Metro mm-hmm. now.
Oh, for real, yeah. And so, I guess what I'm trying to tap into and to understand, when you say the rhythm, yeah, the rhythm, but it's that particular, specific DC beat.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Sound.
That sound. City, talk to sound. Me about that, KK. Yeah.
That's our sound. Like, that's what everybody knows. Like, if you're not from here, they be like, oh, y'all got that go-go music. They always call it that go-go music, which is good because we got our own distinctive sound.
Yeah.
You know, go-go is our sound. That's our stuff. Which the beat, the percussion, the congas, everything. It's just that pump with the pump. It's really, you got to have drums. You can't have the drums without the percussion. You can't percussion without the, you know, the horns. You got to add everything into it to know that sound. See, you have to understand music to like it. Because a lot of people don't like it because they don't understand music. They used to one type of music. They're like, oh, I don't listen to that. I listen to this. I listen to that. If you listen to everything, you will learn what go-go is because it's everything mixed together.
Yeah. Quincy Jones, to your point, Quincy Jones said, what's good? He said, he asked the question. Somebody said, what's good music? He said the same thing that I heard James Brown say on one of his documentaries. Do it sound good, Bird? Do it sound good, Bird? Then it's good music.
And then now, because of Chuck Brown, go-go is in the new museum.
Have
you been there yet?
I haven't been there, but I'm certainly aware that they pay some tribute to Chuck on that.
Oh yeah, he has his own showcase.
And he's about to get inducted in
North Carolina Hall of Fame.
Obviously, you know, this is your father. You totally love him as you should. Chuck helped others to grow, inspire others. Talk to us about the song, Doing the Butt.
Doing the Butt, that's something you gotta talk to Sugar Man.
Well, at the time, that's
the dance that was going on, because they made the song, and of course you gotta make the song to go-go first to see how the crowd, you know, react to it. It was good, they liked it. So the girls started making up a dance for it, which was the butt. You stick your butt out and shake it and move it to the beat.
Yeah.
So they made a video out of it, and that's pretty much it. You just got to know how to shake your butt and how to do it to the beat.
And Spike Lee?
Spike Lee, he was inspired by, you know, Spike Lee loved DC. A lot of artists love DC. They come here, take whatever we get, then run with it, act like they ain't never been here. But you heard, like, we didn't been playing, even when my father started, even when y'all started, whoever started playing live.
Yeah.
They've been doing that for years before rappers thought about doing it. Yeah. Now every rapper got what? A live band.
That's right.
But I'm just like, we been doing it, dog. Yeah. Like, welcome to our world.
I understand that DC needs to get that recognition. We have actual musicians.
And we got talent here.
Soundtracks.
Yes,
we have actual live musicians playing
instruments
the music.
Every
let me
night.
Let Jimmy jump in, and then I want to talk about Mike Epps and his relationship with Chuck.
Every major artist that you can think of handpicked or picked somebody from DC. They handpicked who was the best in D.C., and they got him and took him on the road with them. Number one was us, with Eddie Kendricks.
You know, because you were here during the time, give me your reflections on a young man who was extraordinarily shy, extraordinarily talented. He went to Cardoza High School, named Marvin Gaye.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Give me what did you see and notice about Marvin?
He was a shy person, a shy guy. He was very shy. But you put a mic in his hand, he'll go.
Turned into a whole different person.
Whole different person, like you said.
Yeah.
Whole different person.
Yeah. Now, you were talking about the various artists that come here. And sort of love what's going on. And then they take it back and you see sampling and a piece of the whole DC, what DC offers.
Right.
And you're right. I'll tell you something. I don't think for a second that DC gets the credit that it should get for the influence that it has literally around the world. Now, someone who is not bashful or shy at all about what almost appeared to be, I don't want to put words in his mouth, but what almost appeared to be a worship of Chuck and certain things about DC was what who has become your close friend, your brother, Mike Epps.
Yes, absolutely.
Tell me about how that started.
Mike Epps and Dad were doing a show together at Meriwether some years ago. Mike was the host of the show, and he was like, I got to meet Chuck Brown. My father played Chuck Brown music for me when I was younger.
In Indiana. Right.
And he was like, I can't believe that I'm hosting the show that Mike, you know, that Chuck Brown is playing on. Mm-hmm. So he came to the dressing room. They met, and who doesn't love Chuck once they really meet him, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so they were back there just kicking it in the dressing room, doing what they do, as Mike talked about at the funeral.
He did.
And ever since then, it was just that friendship. And it was just that, you know, it was like family. Mm-hmm. It was like family. Mm-hmm. You know, Mike goes on tour. Before he comes out on tour, he uses Chuck Brown CD, got a bunch of CDs from me. Mm-hmm. We had Tom send him some, you know, and he uses Chuck's music to come out whatever city he's in, not just in DC. Mm-hmm. And I started doing some PR work for him, but he definitely loved Chuck. I'm gonna tell you, when Dad passed away, one of the first phone calls I got was from Mike. Yeah. And I was talking to Mike on the phone, and I'm just thinking that he's at home in L.A. And when they did the candlelight vigil, he stayed on the phone with me while I was down there. And I was trying to call her, but I remember KK wouldn't get out of her truck, you know. So I'm down there talking to Mike. He was making sure I was okay because I told him that she was on her way and she was going to be with me. Mm-hmm. And I never forget, about a couple of days later, I was talking to him, and I said, well, Mike, I know you're busy, but if you can, I would, you know, appreciate if you could come for the service. Yeah. And he said, you know, Cookie, I'm going to do what I can, and I'm going to try to get there. Well, anyway, long story short, we all know that he did come.
Yeah.
But I didn't even know until when he came, and his manager said, you know, Mike really loved Chuck because he was out of the country. I thought I'm talking to him at home in L.A. He was out of the country.
Right.
Flew himself, his manager, and his bodyguard in. Didn't, you know, a lot of celebrities that came, you know, they had to have riders and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Mike covered everything and came to the funeral. Yeah. And I think even Donnie Simpson said when Mike Epps came on the stage, he changed the tone of the funeral, you know, because he brought laughter in, which is what Dad would have wanted.
No
you know?
Question about it. And look, look, I have to take the liberty here to talk about that day and that moment that you're talking about, because Chuck is gone. Like, it's the Godfather is gone. He's passed away. There was a solemn at Howard Howard Field. You know,
Theater.
For the wake. I mean, you know, thousands and thousands of people came by
in the rain.
In the rain.
Later on
absolutely.
That night, it started
it was like it wasn't
storming.
Raining. Yeah. People were just out there. So what I'm talking about here is such a DC moment. I'm just not going to allow us to miss it, because in that convention center, where there were again thousands and thousands and thousands of people who stayed for the service, in addition to those who were there earlier, it was somber. There was the loss of Chuck, and there was sadness. Mm-hmm. And Mike Epps came on the stage, and he talked about a very DC moment, and I just got to share that. And that was that he was, you said they were backstage doing what they do.
What they do.
So Mike wanted to get a little hit on one of them funny kind of cigarettes.
Mm-hmm. But they legal now in DC, right. Aren't they?
Well, I'm just saying. and wanted to get that, and so Chuck was like, okay, here you go, whatever. And no, Mike had it. Chuck wanted to get a little hit. Mm-hmm. Chuck got a little hit. Mike went to the bathroom. When he came back, Chuck had hit it, had taken it all. Mm-hmm. So, oh man, I don't have any more. So Mike asked Chuck, well, where can I get some more? And Chuck picked up his cell phone and said, let me call Marion Barry.
Oh, come on.
That was a DC moment that we could not avoid.
And that was the actual real moment too that happened.
Yeah. When you guys, towards the end, Chuck continued. Here's what I want to ask. Were you aware of him performing while he was hurting?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. When? Give me each an observation.
Probably like 5 months before he passed away.
You remember a particular time? Tell me about it.
He was in the house, and he went to one hospital first. Mm-hmm. They told him it was arthritis. So that's why he thought it was fine. He was taking the arthritis medicine. But his leg just kept getting numb on him. Like after the show, my mother would have to prop it up and keep his leg up so it could be elevated so it wouldn't be so much pressure. Cause it
while he was playing?
This was after the show.
After the show,
it's like he'd probably be standing on stage with his feet swelled up, but you can't tell because it's inside the boot.
Yeah.
So he still would play. He still would sit at the end and take pictures with everybody, even though he was in pain. As soon as he got to the car, he like, but he was always strong the whole way. That's what made me like, never, this is gonna make me never quit in life. And my brothers, because he was always a father to all his kids. Mm-hmm. So he was at every game. They went to Virginia Tech and stuff. You know what I'm saying? So he'd drive down there, back and forth. Like, it's one time my father went and he had a seizure at the game. Nobody knew that, but he passed out in the parking lot.
Yeah.
Nobody knew that but him and my mother. You know what I'm saying? We like, where daddy at? You know, we calling them to see, make sure they're good. Cause I didn't go to the game that time.
Right.
And he passed out, and it's a lot of stuff that he had went through, but you would never know because he never showed it. Like,
right.
He still was like, the fans, he always cared about the fans. Like, even on his bed, I'm not gonna say his deathbed, because even on his hospital bed, when he was under anesthesia, and you know, they give you all these drugs and you doped up, you don't really know what's going on.
Sure.
So I know he was there and he understood what they're saying, but he was asking, am I gonna be able to play again?
Mm-hmm.
That's basically when he let go. When he, you know, because I was, it's a long story. Yeah. I just got into it with the doctors and, you know, I was on them like, that's my father. This is like, it's just how they was talking about him. Mm-hmm. I was like, he's just not somebody. He's a special person. So y'all better do what y'all can for y'all to make sure he make it.
Sure.
Because if he asked me that under this, that's all he cared about was his music, his fans, and his family. So I just really didn't like how the doctors were. Just didn't really like how a lot of it went.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I know I had to stay strong for him, so I didn't cry in front of him.
No,
I didn't do nothing. Right. She called me crying. I'm telling her, stop. Like, I don't know why I'm crying now, because they say I'm
it's
a strong
usually
one.
Me.
Yeah,
right.
But I just don't like
right
talking about that, because when you asked about it, like, it just, that was one of the questions on the bed. He just asked, am I going to be able to play again? If not, he just let go.
You know,
because they were saying he was going to have a 24-hour nurse, and my father was used to doing stuff on his own. Mm-hmm. Like, he was 75, walking still good, healthy, and wasn't nothing wrong. But the whole time, he had a major blockage from his leg up to his heart. Nobody knew that, because he stayed energized and pumped. The doctors didn't even know, because this is the second hospital he went to.
Right.
And as soon as he went there, he had to go to the emergency surgery, so I just knew something wasn't right, because my father didn't want nobody cutting on him.
Yeah.
So when he came out of surgery, he was like, okay, I'm good, even though I didn't want it. So then they said, well, Mr. Brown, we got to go back again. He like, y'all got to cut me again?
Yeah.
That's the last thing he was able to say. He told us, all of us, that he loved us, but that's the last thing he was able to say was, y'all got to cut me open again?
Mm.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so,
I do. So in that heart that you talk about is a heart that, you know, again, you know, when we come to do a show like this, you know, we try to understand and be prepared so that we can talk, you know, intelligently about who and what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And part of what we saw and understood from different people we talked, that Chuck would do a deal, but the deal had to be that if his son was playing football, it had to be where he could play, where Chuck could go and play his music, but come back.
Be at the game.
Be at the game. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So in terms of, you know, that's the kind of father that he was.
Family first, fans was second.
Yeah.
Family first. I mean, you know, grandchildren, you know, everybody. I mean, oh my goodness.
I remember my nephew. My brother was holding him, and we went to go see his body to make sure he was good. And my nephew just turned his head and was like, that's not my papa. Where my papa at? Because you know my father used to be live. And
yes, indeed.
So kids understand death, I guess.
Because
he was like 3 or 4 then. He was just like, that's not papa. Like, where my papa at?
Yeah. So Jimmy, you know, as you observed, you know, whether it was Chuck or Sugar Bear or James Funk or or whoever it was that might have been getting sort of the spotlight and the steam and the sizzle. How did you feel about something that you touched very early on becoming so significant to this area, and then through these other individuals literally being exported to the world?
Well, for one thing, I felt very proud. Mm-hmm. We all did, the young senators. Mm-hmm. Felt very proud. Number one, we wasn't in the city then. We were gone. We were hitting the road.
Sure.
So we was on the road. So somebody had to take over.
Uh-huh.
The number one and the number two bands in Washington was the Soul Searchers, were the Young Senators and the Soul Searchers.
Uh-huh.
That's written.
Mm-hmm.
Can't nobody change that.
Mm-hmm.
That's been written.
Mm-hmm.
But to answer your question, I felt very proud.
Mm-hmm.
Very proud, because here we are in Los Angeles. We don't know what's going on in D.C.
Right.
You know, with Eddie Kendrick. So, hey, he carried it on. Chuck carried it on.
Mm-hmm. You know, you said you are a percussionist.
Yes, sir.
And you said that with a sense of that this is part of the identity.
Yes, sir.
Of who you are.
Yes, sir.
Can you explain that a little more?
It's hard to understand. It's hard to explain. But it's something that the Creator God gave me. I never went to school for percussionists. I never was taught by percussionists, but I played with all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And what I took from each one was something.
Mm-hmm.
I took something from each one
mm-hmm.
and made it my own identity.
Mm-hmm.
Made it myself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's something that unmistakably you feel came through you from a higher power.
I remember on stage, yes sir, I didn't have nothing to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was just standing on stage.
Right.
And something say, buy some Kungas.
Mm-hmm.
I looked around me, what was it? Buy some Kungas.
Mm-hmm.
It was God speaking. So next day I went to Campbell Music Store
mm-hmm.
at 13th and G.
Mm-hmm.
Bought some Kungas. Didn't know how to play.
Mm-hmm.
When I played that night, I didn't know what I was doing.
Yeah.
I couldn't squeeze my hands to drive myself home. I drove like this.
Because you had played and wore your hands out?
Wore my hands out.
Uh-huh.
But I kept doing it. I kept going.
I just kept
going.
Yeah.
Till finally I mastered it.
Uh-huh.
That's all. You got to have a desire for it.
And KK, staying with the concept and the idea of that artists aren't necessarily made, they're born.
Mm-hmm.
When did you first discover that you had a talent that you would be able to participate and be in your father's band and participate? Well, did that come early on, or?
It was like in like 87, I think I was like
and
eight.
And you were how old?
I was eight.
Take me back to when you were eight.
When I was eight, we was in the living room watching my father on Go-Go Live, because of course I wasn't old enough to go in there. So when I seen what was going on at Go-Go Live, I was like, Daddy, I want to be on the stage with you one day. He was like, sure, when you grow up, when you practice, then you can get on stage with Daddy, gonna put you on stage with him. And I used to, me, my cousins, we all used to write the songs, like, because back then they was doing like top 40s and songs from other rappers.
Mm-hmm.
And I just knew I was just the best rapper because I was so pressed to know everybody's words. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So back then we had how you can Google and just get the song, we had to write them down.
Uh-huh.
So me and my cousin used to write the lyrics to the songs, and then me and my other cousin used to like battle each other and back and forth.
Who was a big influence on you from a rapper?
MC Light.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love
mm-hmm.
her.
Mm-hmm. And do you remember the first lyrics?
Light as a rock.
That got you? Light as a rock?
Light as a rock.
Can you bust one?
I love like Georgie Porgy, man, everything
come on,
she
come on.
Do.
Come on. The early one, something
everything
early, something
she
early
do.
That just really caught you.
Man.
You didn't ask me to rap.
Nah, I'm not gonna
say. I can't.
Because I got so much. When she like, when you talk, it don't really matter. It just come out as just chit chatter. Like,
yeah.
You know when people, that's, everything MC Light do is,
uh-huh.
When I met her, I wasn't starstruck and I like hugged her like I knew her. Because
mm-hmm.
I just told her I listened to her since she was young. You know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
all the, everything she said, I liked her because I like her style because she was different.
Yeah.
she was always with the dudes, and she kind of reminded me of me because I got a lot of brothers, and, you know, cousins, and I used to always hang with the boys instead of the girl. Like, my sister never was being prissy. I was just trying to be a little tomboy.
Her,
I
just wanted, her being prissy.
That thing is a mess right there. So I just wanted to be, I just wanted to be the little tomboy around all the dudes, and I've been like that all my life. I've just been around dudes all my life, and she just reminded me of her because she was just so humble. She real, everything she rapped about. She rapped basically like a dude, but she was a female, so you had to respect her for that.
And
that's how I rap.
Cause she go.
Right. Yeah, I'm telling
you. Now, we're gonna come back to you. We got just a little over 5 minutes left. You think about what you want to take us out on, because like the last minute, I'm gonna make that a KK minute. But before we go to that KK minute,
ready for that?
I want to come over here to Cookie, because I see the group that you are managing. Do you ever give them a day off?
No. Mm-hmm. Well, Mondays sometimes.
Talk to us about the group, who makes up the group, what's been going on, and what the future holds.
Team Familiar, well, hopefully the future is as bright as the lights are. So Team Familiar is definitely a junior Chuck Brown group. We have Donnell Floyd, Go-Go Mickey, Miss Kim, and
you're saying Scooby names like very casually,
and
but the go-go community
Frank Sirius, who now is with KK on the stage with the Chuck Brown band too. So he is just like he said he's the godson.
He's the godson.
We have Kesey, who is just one of the most amazing singers. Jam and Jeff, the drummer, Bojack. Mm-hmm. I did the whole front line, everybody, keyboard, Mike. We put together, you know, a tremendous band. So, you know, we are.
I remember walking into the MGM when they were first announcing that they were going to do a $1 billion project here.
Right. Oh, we opened
and I heard this go-go beat, and I was like,
That was Dad's band.
I know. Mm-hmm. This is the MGM, and here's how they're opening up. They know a little
they
something.
They better come. Yeah. They better come correct. You know. Yeah. But Team Familiar, we play 5 nights a week, twice on Saturdays. So Donnell Floyd, you know, he gets that band out there. I don't know if you remember when Lil Benny passed away.
Sure.
My dad brought Donnell to his band, to be his backup. Yeah. And then one thing I can tell you about Donnell, I'll never forget when I saw him sitting at my dad's funeral. If I didn't know how much he loved Chuck, the look and just what he was going through sitting there let me know how much he loved Chuck. Yeah. So that helped me love Donnell even more. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
But diva.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, Team Familiar is just here to bring it and keep Dad's legacy alive. And his legacy means playing good music, being a total 100% band, and making sure the people have fun. And
so
that's what we're doing.
I wrote something on Facebook after Chuck passed, and it was something to the effect of, I was concerned that there was such a vacuum and a void being left, that part of the sadness of the city was one thing for a Chuck Brown concert was black, white, Hispanic, old, Asian. It didn't matter. It was like when you walk through that door of a Chuck Brown concert, you walk through and you know, when they did We Are the World, Quincy Jones told everybody, check your ego at the door. Right. Well, when you came through the door of a Chuck Brown concert, it's like, okay, leave your identity behind because we all are one up in here. Mm-hmm. And part of my remembering was being at one of the concerts and Chuck calling out, you know, as you well know, he called out Felicia. And my niece was there, and she just knew he was talking to her. And there could be 2,000 people in a room, and it's like every single individual in that room felt as if Chuck was talking to or playing for them.
Absolutely.
Jimmy, that's an incredibly special gift, huh?
It is.
That's something that was... That's him. That was Chuck Brown, and that's why people loved it. He could go nowhere without people seeing him and wanting to take a picture, wanting to autograph, and he would take every picture. I remember when we were at the Boulevard had a record store out there, and one of the CDs had just come out, and I went out there, and I was with him, and I was like, okay, good, it's 9:30, we can go now.
Yeah.
It was still a line, and he said, oh, no, I'm staying until the last person.
And now we only have a minute left, but one of the things is the icon that he became and how D.C. honored him with the lottery and everything else that was going on. Bang!
This baby girl always been known for blowing up spots, and I don't give a if they like me or not. Determine I'm hot, no time for games. To the point, KK is about to rock this funky joint like back in the 80s with the rope gold chains, a remix, a real chick getting fortune and fame. One day you're on top, the next you're not. Got them hating on me because they know I can't be stopped. I want it all, taking her slot, forget what she got. Getting money is my option, being broke is not. Getting money, see, y'all know what I'm talking about. Next time grown folks talking, man, close your mouth.
Whoa.
We got this show on lock, and the host is named Rock. And thank you very much for coming in
here. Oh, my goodness.
That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, and God bless the go-go world.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.